In today's video lecture, we are going to see section 6 of this chapter, which is titled Homotopic Version of Cauchy's Theorem and Simple Connectivity. And in this lecture, we are going to see what homotopy is and how is Cauchy's Theorem derived from the same. So the condition that integral over gamma f is equal to 0 for a closed curve gamma could be leading to the fact that f is an analytic function by Moreira's theorem, which we had seen. And also we know that for an analytic function f and a closed curve gamma, integral over gamma f is equal to 0, which also we have seen. So we are going to prove the same with respect to the new concept we are going to introduce, which is called homotopy. So this concept, integral over gamma f is equal to 0 for a closed curve gamma and analytic function f, can be a path which helps us to introduce a concept of simply connected region. And you can see as of here, in a simply connected region, the Cauchy's theorem is valid for every analytic function and every closed rectifiable curve. So that is our idea of this section, how to develop this fact. So suppose if G, we are considering the open connected set, is nothing but the open disk centered at A with radius capital R. And suppose if gamma from closed interval 0, 1 to G be a closed rectifiable curve. So gamma is a function, a continuous function from closed interval 0, 1 to the open connected set or open disk G, like this. So it is mapped to the points of gamma. Suppose if 0 less than or equal to t less than or equal to 1 and 0 less than or equal to s less than or equal to 1, we are defining a point z, which is nothing but the line segment joining the points a and gamma of s. Let a be, you know what is a. A is the center of the open disk we are considering. We are joining that A with a point gamma S, which is a point on the curve. So this is nothing but the definition of a line segment joining A and gamma S. So Z is equal to TA plus 1 minus T into gamma of S. Here T is varying from 0 to T, S is varying from 0 to 1. We know that's how we define gamma. So Z is a point. Z will lie. This implies that Z is a linear combination of A and gamma of S. It is not a line segment, but it is lying on the line segment joining A and gamma S. So since A is inside G and gamma of S is inside G, and G being an open disk, we know that the point Z will obviously lie inside G. Suppose if gamma t of s is defined, a new function gamma t of s is defined such that that is equal to t a plus 1 minus t into gamma of s, and s is varied here and also t is varied here. That's how we define a function. But this was a point. We had fixed s and this was actually a point, gamma of s, and correspondingly z was a point. But here we are varying s and t. So you have a function here, gamma t of s. So here we are calculating gamma 0 of s. Gamma 0 of s will be 0 into a plus 1 minus 0 into gamma of s, which is nothing but gamma of s. So what you get is gamma naught is equal to gamma. And also gamma 1 of s. Gamma 1 of s will be 1 into a plus 1 minus 1 into gamma of s, that is nothing but a. Okay, so gamma 1 is the curve constantly equal to a. That's what it means. So that's an idea there, how it is coming. And suppose and any other curve gamma t will lie in between this gamma 0 and gamma 1, right? So we were able to draw gamma down to A because there were no holes inside G. So suppose if a point inside gamma were missing from G, so suppose if this was G, the open disk, and there was a hole here, okay? So the gamma is like this. But the points of gamma, all the points of gamma will not be in G because there is a hole here. That's what which is said here. So if a point inside gamma were missing from, there are many points of gamma which are missing from G in the figure here. Okay. Missing from G, then as gamma shrinks, it would get caught on the hole and will not go to constant curve. So if suppose if this gamma is made up of a rubber material, so if we are trying to shrink the gamma, since there is a hole here, we are not able to shrink it towards here. But if there was no hole, we could have been able to do that. That's what it means. So now we are moving on to when two curves, closed rectifiable curves gamma naught and gamma 1, are homotopic. Suppose if gamma naught and gamma 1 are two closed rectifiable curves, definitely they are from closed level 0, 1 to G. G is the open connected set in the region. Then gamma naught is defined to be homotopic to gamma 1 G if we are able to find a continuous function capital gamma from closed interval 0, 1 cross 0, 1, Cartesian product of 0, 1, 0, 1 with itself, to G such that capital gamma of S0 is equal to small gamma of S, gamma naught of S, capital gamma of S1 is equal to gamma 1, small gamma 1 of S, where S is varying from 0 to 1, capital gamma of 0t is equal to capital gamma of 1t, where t is varying from 0 to 1. So here we can understand that this capital gamma is having the domain 0, 1 cross 0, 1. So it will be like this, 0, 1 cross 0, 1. And suppose if this is the point here is S, so that point is represented as the ordered pair S0. And when we are applying this gamma, this S0 should be the corresponding gamma naught of S here. Similarly, if this is T, so the representation will be ordered pair 0, T. So this point, when it is mapped by this gamma, that will go to gamma 1 of T. We call it T. Okay, gamma 1 of T. Similarly, gamma, this will be ordered pair S1 and this will be ordered pair 1T, and their corresponding images should be equal. So that's what the definition says. So if we define gamma T from closed interval 0, 1 to G, defined as gamma T of S is equal to capital gamma of ST, then each gamma t is a closed curve and they are forming a continuous family of curves which start at gamma 0 and go to gamma 1 as we had mentioned earlier. Now, if two curves are homotopic, we write gamma tilde gamma, gamma naught tilde gamma 1 as like this. And we are now going to show that this relation tilde is an equivalence relation. So first you have to show that the relation is reflexive, then you have to show that it is symmetric, then you have to show that it is transitive. So for that, first gamma naught is homotopic to gamma naught, or gamma naught tilde gamma naught. Why? Because we are able to define a continuous function capital gamma from closed interval 0, 1 cross closed interval 0, 1 to G such that gamma of ST is equal to small gamma of s, we are defining so. Okay, then we have to say that those three conditions which we mentioned earlier are satisfied, 1, 2, and 3. 1, 2, and 3. We have to prove that for this particular capital gamma. So here this capital gamma of S0 is equal to gamma naught of S. Capital gamma S1 is equal to gamma naught of S, right, by the definition. Similarly, capital gamma of 0t will be equal to gamma 0 of S, gamma 0 of 0, which is equal to gamma 0 of 1, because gamma 0 is a closed curve. We have already taken it as a closed rectifiable curve. And also gamma 0 of 1 will be nothing but capital gamma of 1t, where 0 less than or equal to t less than or equal to 1. And here for both of them, 0 less than or equal to s less than or equal to 1. So this means that tilde is reflexive. Similarly, suppose if gamma naught is homotopic to gamma 1, we have to prove that gamma 1 is homotopic to gamma naught. So since gamma naught is homotopic to gamma 1, we have the guarantee for the existence of a continuous function capital gamma 1, continuous function capital gamma 1 from closed interval 01 cross closed interval 01 to G, such that capital gamma 1 of S0 is equal to the three conditions, is equal to gamma naught of S, capital gamma 1 of S1 is equal to small gamma 1 of S, capital gamma 1 of 0t is equal to capital gamma 1 of 1t for every 0 less than or equal to t less than or equal to 1. Here s is varying from 0 to 1. So we have to define a new function so that to assert the this condition. Okay, so we are going to define capital gamma 2 from closed interval 01 cross closed interval 01 to g, such that capital gamma 2 st is equal to capital gamma 1 s comma 1 minus t. Okay, so we have to prove the three conditions here. Then consider gamma capital gamma 2 of s0. So capital gamma 2 of s0 is defined to be capital gamma 1 of s1, but capital gamma of s1 we already know it to be small gamma of gamma 1 of s. Now capital gamma 2 of s1 is nothing but capital gamma 1 of s comma 0. That is nothing but gamma naught of S. Similarly, capital gamma 2 of 0t is equal to capital gamma 1 of 0 comma 1 minus t, which is equal to capital gamma 1 of 1 comma 1 minus t, because this is satisfied for every t in between 0 and 1. And that is nothing but capital gamma 2 of 1 comma t for every t varying in between 0 and 1. So this means that tilde is symmetric. Now we have to show the transitivity condition. Suppose if gamma naught tilde gamma 1, gamma 1 tilde gamma 2, then we have to show that gamma naught tilde gamma 2. Okay. So since gamma naught tilde gamma 1, we have the existence of capital gamma 1, continuous function. Similarly, since gamma 1 tilde gamma 2, we have the existence of the continuous function capital gamma 2, such that they satisfy the three properties which are written here. Okay, so we are going to define a new function capital gamma 3 from 01 cross 01 to g, such that capital gamma 3 of st is equal to capital gamma 1 of s comma 2t, where t is varying from 1 to 0 to 1 by 2. That means for the first part we are increasing, doubling the t here, and then the second part from 1 by 2 to 1 you have it to be capital gamma 2 of s comma 2t minus 1. Okay, so here we have to show the three conditions, where gamma 3 of s0 is equal to gamma 1 as defined, it is equal to, because 0 is in between 0 and 1 by 2. So you have gamma 1 of s into s comma 2 into 0, that is gamma 1 of s0, which is equal to small gamma 0 of s. Similarly, gamma 3 of s1, when we follow the steps, you get it to be gamma 2 of s. and gamma 3 of 0 t by the definition you can verify and understand that gamma 3 of 1 t that is equal to gamma 3 of 1 t for every t less than or 0 less than or equal to t less than or equal to 1. And we have arrived at the fact that gamma naught is homotopic to gamma 3, and hence the transitivity condition is also satisfied. So the relation tilde will be always a equivalence relation. So we have proved it. And you can go through the steps given in the text too, which are the same. Instead of gamma 1 and gamma 2, here they have taken gamma and capital gamma. Lambda, capital lambda and capital gamma. And next is a definition of a convex set. A set G is a convex set if any two given points A and B in G. The line segment joining A and B will lie entirely inside G. You are familiar with it. Now a set G is a star shaped if there is a point a star-shaped set if there is a point small a in G such that for each z in G, the line segment AZ lies entirely in G. So you can understand that this will be a star-shaped set. And clearly every convex set will be star-shaped, but the reverse is not true because see, this is a star-shaped set, but if we have two points from here and here, if we join them, the line joining them will not be completely inside the set. So it is not a convex set. Now, what is called an A star-shaped set? If we fix a small a belongs to G, and if every other point inside this G will have the line segment from A to that point, right? That line segment should lie completely inside the set we are talking about. Then that set will be called A star shaped. So you can see that this is an A star shaped set where we have fixed A to be this point. Okay. If G is A star shaped and Z and W are points in G, then Z, A, W is a polygon in G. So here, we can join them like this. So this will be a polygon. A, Z, W will definitely be a polygon. So which will give us the logic that each star-shaped set will be a connected set. Now proposition 6.4 gives, suppose if G is an open set which is A star-shaped. Okay, and gamma naught is the curve which is constantly equal to A, then every closed rectifiable curve in G is homotopic to gamma naught. Suppose G is an open set. So we know that G is an open set and gamma naught is a constant curve. That means gamma naught of S is equal to A for, say, it is A for every 0 less than or equal to S less than or equal to 1. And we are given that gamma 1 is a closed rectifiable curve. Okay, so suppose we are given gamma 1 is a closed rectifiable curve. Okay, then we have to show that each such closed rectifiable curve is homotopic to gamma naught, where gamma naught is a constant set, constant function, constant curve. So we have to find a function capital gamma such that this gamma 1, the arbitrary curve gamma 1, which is closed and rectifiable, and gamma naught are homotopic. So define capital gamma from 0, 1 cross 0, 1 to G such that capital gamma of ST is equal to T into gamma 1 of S plus 1 minus T into gamma naught of S. So that is equal to t into gamma 1 of s plus 1 minus t into a, because gamma naught of s is a constant. Now since G is a star-shaped set, we know that any point which is a star-shaped, right? So any point which is joined to any line which is joined to this point A will lie inside G, right? So definitely this gamma st will completely lie inside G for any s and t lying in between 0 and 1. And now we have to check for the three conditions. Gamma s naught is equal to 0 into gamma 1 s plus 1 minus 0 into gamma naught of s, which is equal to gamma naught of s, which is equal to a. And gamma of s1 is equal to 1 into gamma 1 of s plus 0 into gamma naught of s, which will be equal to gamma 1 of s. Then capital gamma of 0t is equal to t into gamma 1 of 0 plus 1 minus t into gamma naught of 0, where this gamma naught of 0 is nothing but a. And also this gamma 1 of 0 can be replaced by gamma 1 of 1, because gamma 1 is a closed curve. Okay. And then you can write, instead of a, you can write gamma naught of 1. It's okay, because gamma naught is a constant function. So we can write it to be a is equal to gamma naught of 1. So this is nothing but capital gamma of 1t. So all the three conditions for the function are satisfied. That means gamma 1 will be homotopic to gamma naught, which is nothing but the constant a. So that we have now proved theorem, the proposition 6.4. Okay, and next is a definition which is saying that suppose if gamma is a closed rectifiable curve in G, then gamma is homotopic to 0, or we write it gamma tilde 0, if gamma is homotopic to a constant curve. If gamma is homotopic to any constant curve, that means we say that gamma is homotopic to 0. Okay, so we are moving on to how to prove Cauchy's theorem. First version we already proved in the last section. So we will prove Cauchy's theorem second version here. So here it says that if f is a function, analytic function from G to C, and gamma is a closed rectifiable curve in G such that gamma is homotopic to 0, that means gamma is homotopic to a constant curve, then integral over gamma f is equal to 0. So if gamma is homotopic to a constant curve, or gamma is homotopic to 0, then we say that integral over gamma f is equal to 0. So in order to prove this, this will actually follow if n gamma w is equal to 0 for all w in C minus D. We have to prove this. So if we prove this from Cauchy's theorem, the first version, which says that if G is an open subset, Cauchy's first theorem says that if G is, I'll just write it, what is Cauchy's first theorem? It says that G is an open set, open subset of complex plane, and f from G to C is an analytic function, and if gamma 1, gamma 2, etc., gamma m are closed rectifiable curves in G such that n gamma 1 of w plus etc. plus n gamma 2 of w is equal to 0 for every w belongs to C minus G, then we had proved that summation k is equal to 1 to m integral over gamma k f is equal to 0. So here, suppose if we proved n gamma w is equal to 0, we just have one closed curve here instead of m closed rectifiable curves, we have just one. And we know, if suppose we know that n gamma w is equal to 0, then the theorem will automatically follow from Cauchy's theorem, first version. Cauchy's theorem, first version. So how to prove n gamma w is equal to 0 for all w belongs to c minus g? We are going to prove it. Let gamma 1 is equal to gamma, and let gamma naught be a constant curve such that gamma 1 tilde gamma naught. Okay. Let capital gamma satisfy all the three conditions which we have said when two curves are homotopic. We know that gamma 1 and gamma naught are homotopic. So capital gamma satisfies those three conditions. Now define as small h of t, which is equal to the index of gamma t, winding number of gamma t with respect to the, relative to the point w. Okay, where this gamma t of s is nothing but capital gamma of st, where s and t are varying from 0 to 1. And w is fixed inside c minus t, c minus t. Since h of t is equal to n, which is the winding number or the index, we know that it is an integer valued function, and also it is continuous on closed interval 0, 1. We had already proved that the winding number is continuous and integer value. We had proved in earlier theorems. So since it is continuous and integer valued, and also h of 0 is nothing but n gamma 0 w, where gamma 0 is nothing but the constant curve a, so you can write it that to be equal to n a w. And this is a point, a is a point, and w is we have to say how many times this w is this a is winding around w. But a being just a point, we can say that the winding number is 0. Okay, so h of 0 is 0, and we know that h is continuous and integer value. That will mean that h of t is nothing but the constant function 0. So in particular, you get that n gamma w will be 0 for all c minus g. So in that case, by rephrasing Cauchy's theorem first version, we will obtain the desired result. So that's how homotopy is used to prove Cauchy's theorem second version. And thank you for watching out this video, and see you in the next video lecture, which deals with the next part of the same section 6. So thank you so much.